Breitbart in the white boat. But watch that blue boat from East Germany.
Hey, lane 8 and 7, Bobkowski of the Soviet Union making a move. No, no, Horton slightly ahead. Slightly ahead. It's a two-boat
race.
Davies
here at the
comes
bottom.
Davies of Australia.
It's Breitbart.
I think he did it. I think he did it.
And he didn't have much more time than that to celebrate, as less than an hour later, he found himself back on the Hahn with Norman Bellingham attempting to win a second gold in the 1,000-meter two-man event.
Look at Buck Barton pull that boat, gaining on the Aussies, gaining on New Zealand.
Inch by inch by inch by inch.
He loves his headwind. Uh-oh, New Zealand looks like
Zealand's
they got a second place
spurt
at the top.
Top of your screen.
A tremendous spurt by New Zealand. The Americans have to respond right now, but it looks like they're going to medal.
The bottom of your screen, Greg and Norm, there they are. Stroking well. It's an all-out sprint.
They're going to, hey, they did it. I think they did it. I think Barton is doubled.
The host city of Seoul is sometimes called the Miracle on the Hahn. These two performed a little bit of that in 1988 themselves. The homegrown martial art of Taekwondo, invented in Korea more than 2,000 years ago. Taekwondo was a demonstration sport here in Seoul, and the home team fully demonstrated its superiority. Korea captured 15 medals, 9 of them gold, in an expected show of strength. What wasn't expected was the performance of the United States. 11 total medals with 4 golds, including one for welterweight Arlene Limas. Limas, a student at DePaul University in Chicago, went all the way to the gold in her first international competition. And in one of the game's most memorable moments, Limas and the crowd improvised the singing of the national anthem when the tape player at the venue failed. For Limas and her vocalists, the stars and stripes never looked so bright. Table tennis is a sport bordering on obsession in Asia, and it drew large and enthusiastic crowds in Seoul. The sport has long been dominated by the men and women of China, and indeed, the Chinese women swept the medals in singles. But in doubles, the Korean reigning world champions captured the gold to the delight of the hometown crowd. In men's singles, it was an all-Korean final. Yoonam Kyu, a native of Busan who trains in Sweden part of the year, versus Kim Ki-taek, whose father helped start the Korean national table tennis team. With Yu and Green up 2-1, leading in game 4, the two teammates put on one of the best rallies of the games. Then it was match point, with Yu receiving serve.
Game to Yu, 23-21. He wins the match 3-1.
Yu captured the gold, Kim the silver, and Erik Lind of Sweden the bronze. Then tears of joy for the table tennis gold medalist.
Bob Costas.
Thank you, David Perry. The centerpiece of every Olympic Games is track and field, and Seoul proved no exception. The main Olympic stadium, right behind me here, played host to some legends of the sport, including hurdler Edwin Moses, back for a try at a third gold. The Games would also crown new kings. Future stars would emerge. On the men's side, Americans dominated the sprints, and Africans swept the distances. The field events were controlled by the Eastern Bloc, but there were some surprises. We begin the look back at men's track and field with the shot put.
Now, Randy Barnes in fourth place, his final throw of the competition. He's been a little conservative up to this point. This is the last throw. He's got to let it go. And he lets this one fly. 73 feet, 5.5 inches. He takes the lead from Timmerman. He has the gold medal right now. The only man who can take it away from him is Ulf Timmerman. The Big East German has been stellar all day long. 3 Olympic records in this competition to this point. But he saves his best for the final throw of the competition.
Timmerman's toss was good enough for gold. Barnes, a surprise silver medalist. Edwin Moses fought Father Time and teammate Andre Phillips in the 400-meter hurdles, and he finally lost his grip on Olympic gold.
The race to the first hurdle, and Edwin wins it.
Here comes Andre Phillips. Can Edwin catch him? One barrier to go. Look out for Amadou Diaba. Phillips, Diaba, and Moses.
Now, Christo Markov of Bulgaria, the 1986 European champion, the 1987 world champion, and the favorite for the gold medal, makes his first jump count, going 57.9 and a half, an Olympic record, and good enough for the gold medal. He put the pressure on in the very first frame, and it was all downhill from there.
The overwhelming favorite in the high jump was Patrick Chaubert. He took the silver in L.A. and was tabbed for gold in Seoul, but the Swede fell short, missing all 3 jumps at 7 feet 9 3/4. And he wound up with bronze. American Hollis Conway took an unexpected silver. With Chaubert faltering, a Soviet jumper, Gennady Avdyenko, took center stage. He cleared the height on his second attempt. His performance was one of the few bright spots for the Soviet men's track and field team. The 6'7", 180-pound Avdyenko had the winning form in Seoul.
Top 3 finishers in each of the 5 heats to move through to the semifinals. Plus one other best time.
Carl, looks like he's going to go hard and then coast. Run the turn hard, take a look, see where everyone is. Looks over. He's in good shape right here. He's going to ease in.
Just enough.
After the heats of the men's 200 meters, Lewis moved right on to the finals of the long jump. Battling fatigue, his third leap fell short of 28 feet. The officials told the American star that he'd have to jump first in the next round, and Lewis protested.
I mean, you came to me and said jump 12th because of the 200. So I did that on your behalf. No, you didn't tell me, but they told me. Then you come back and say, you have to jump first, jump now. That's not fair.
Although the officials still forced him to lead off the next round, Lewis's protest did buy him a little time, and it might have done him some good. On his fourth attempt, he leaped 28.7 and a half. Good enough for gold. And Lewis became the first man in Olympic history to win the long jump twice. The silver and bronze went to his teammates, Mike Powell and Larry Myricks, an American sweep. Kenyan Paul Arang, an unheralded University of Virginia sophomore, won the 800 meters. Arang was the first of 4 Kenyans to win gold on the Olympic track as Africans took every event from 800 to 10,000.
Atkinson is out of it. He's dropping all the way back. Scott is still in it. It is Rono leading.
But Steve Scott is a little bit boxed. He's got someone on his outside. He better get free.
Elliott is second. Graham is third. Jens Peter Hill.
Now the sprint has really started.
And here comes the kick down the final straight. Jens Peter Hill on the inside. Elliott outside. And then Graham. Scott is not going to medal. Can Rono hang on? He does. Elliott. And then Jens Peter Hill and Steve Graham.
Second place hurdle, but that's not
going to
be enough.
One barrier remaining. There's a hurdle and another hurdle and another hurdle. Julius Karyuki, Peter Koech, Mark Rowland of Great Britain, the gold, the silver, and the bronze. And they just missed the world record. 8:05.51, still another Olympic record. And here comes Dieter Bellman. For the silver, he passes Castro. Hunter Kutcher, there's the goal. Castro's going to be shut out.
4, Arthur Blake in 5, Tony Campbell in 6. And it looked like Arthur Blake caught a flyer.
Arthur Blake did catch a flyer.
Here comes Roger Kingdom. It is Kingdom out in front.
And Blake is out of it. He's chopped out.
Kingdom has the gold. Colin Jackson of Great Britain comes through for the silver. And Tony Campbell has the bronze.
$12.99, Charlie. And the wind is under the allowable the third time that a hurdler has gone under 13 flat, and now Roger Kingdom has two of them. Not only a great victory, but a tremendous time. If he misses this height, he is not a medalist. So this is where Book of the Competitor surfaced. A huge clearance, 19.4 and a quarter. And he was pretty happy about it. An all or nothing vault at a height few men have ever cleared. And he finally got his technique together on this particular jump. It's one of the few tailwinds in the competition. The best plan he had all day, it was almost right over his head. And look at this clearance. That might have been a 20-foot jump with a bar at 19.4 and a quarter.
Steve Lewis.
Steve Lewis!
Then it is Danny Everett. Butch Reynolds is going to chase them all. You're looking at an American sweep. The first time since 1968. Lewis, Reynolds, Everett. Carl Lewis does not have a world record. Joe DeLoach outside in 6. It is DeLoach in front of Lewis. It is Lewis and DeLoach. It is DeLoach and Lewis. DeLoach!
DeLoach!
Joe DeLoach to the United States. Carl Lewis with the silver.
Some car warranties give you protection on your powertrain beyond the first year, which is fine if you are only buying a powertrain. But GM is the only American manufacturer to protect the powertrain and the thousands of other parts that go into all our 89 cars and light trucks. Everything. For 3 years or 50,000 miles, it covers parts, labor, and towing. The GM Bumper to Bumper Plus Warranty. Longer protection for more of your car or truck.
What? Do you have a question? Your hand has been up as long as I've been here.
I just can't do it. It's just something.
Come on!
Sally Field, Tom Hanks, Punchline.
Yes, that's funny.
Rated R. Now at select theaters. Starts Friday at theaters nationwide.
Listen. Listen to the taste. Listen to the taste.
Fresh all day at my place.
Good time.
Listen to the great taste of McDonald's.
Here's some news that's going to change the world. U.S. Sprint announces the world's first international long-distance sale. Sign up now and save as much as 10 to 34% for 3 full months. If you make international calls, this sale can make all the difference in the world. So call now and save during U.S. Sprint's international long-distance sale.
Sports presentation of the games of the 24th Olympiad, the tribute, the test, and the triumph, is brought to you by United Airlines, airline of the 1980s.